In this section, we will relatively correlate between the Raynaud's phenomenon or Raynaud's syndrome to Borzer disease. Now, starting from the Raynaud's phenomenon is usually due to the arteriolospasm in the distal portion of our limb. Usually, the most commonly affected limb is the lower limb. Okay, now what is the clinical presentation? There are three triad which should be remembered as a clinical presentation. Suppose that this is our limb and this is the arterial supply, and during the arterial spasm there is no supply to the distal portion of the limb. As a result, there will be presence of asphyxia, which will be presented as pallor. Okay, means the first feature will be our pallor. Then once the deoxygenated hemoglobin in the distal portion is elevated, that will be presented as cyanosis. This is the second component. But now after the stimuli has been removed, this arteriolospasm is usually predisposed after the stimuli. We will study in the types that the Raynaud's phenomenon is divided into primary and secondary, and the primary Raynaud's phenomenon is also known as the Raynaud's disease. This is different thing, means Raynaud's phenomenon or Raynaud's disease is two different component. Phenomenon includes primary as well as secondary Raynaud's, whereas the Raynaud's disease is just the primary. And usually the primary Raynaud's disease is idiopathic, usually seen in female patient, and the bilateral upper limb is affected, whereas lower limb is very rarely affected. And the usual and the most common stimuli which influence the primary Raynaud's disease is cold exposure. And once the cold exposure is removed, about 15 to 20 minutes it takes to resolve the symptoms. And after the resolution of the symptoms, the blood supply, means this vasospasm, is again reperfused. And during reperfusion, the blood supply, reperfusion of the blood supply, the patient feels pain as well as flushing of the blood can be seen from the outer layer, because there was pallor in earlier state, and once the blood perfusion is established, there will be flushing. So these were the clinical presentation in Raynaud's phenomenon. Once the vasospasm was present, there was pallor and cyanosis, and if the perfusion is maintained again, there will be flushing and pain. And suppose that if the stimuli or the cause is persist for a longer period, then what will be the result? Means due to this obstruction in the artery, the limbs undergoes gangrene formation or ulceration. Okay. So this we have studied about the general mechanism or the general fact about the Raynaud's phenomenon. We saw that it is divided into primary and secondary type. Primary is also known as Raynaud's disease, usually it is idiopathic, whereas secondary is due to collagen vascular disease like scleroderma, rheumatoid arthritis, or SLE. Some of the other cause of the primary Raynaud's phenomenon can be cervical ribs, Scalin syndrome, and the pathophysiology. Now coming to the pathophysiology, when the Raynaud's phenomenon during exposure to the cold, there is increased amount of epinephrine, serotonin, and thromboxane. And we know that these components are responsible for the vasoconstriction. Okay, serotonin, epinephrine, and thromboxane are vasoconstrictor, which will predispose or increase the amount of the angiospasm. And the vasodilators like nitric oxide and endothelin 1 is decreased, and which will further increase the amount of the vasospasm in the arteriole. So this is the pathogenesis in the Raynaud's phenomenon. Now we need to know the what will be the investigation. The primary Raynaud's disease is usually clinically diagnosed by looking for the feature and the other related symptoms like bilateral, femoral, and cold exposure is predisposing. But investigation should be sent accordingly for the diagnosis of the secondary type of Raynaud's phenomenon, that the disease is very varying, no? So we should go for these disease investigation like rheumatoid arthritis, SLE and scleroderma. Now the treatment modality. The treatment modality for the Raynaud's or the primary type of the disease is usually conservative, that protection from the cold. Cold say protection. Then and we should also remember that the other limbs, other fingers are usually affected, and the thumb is usually spared in case of the Raynaud's phenomenon or Raynaud's disease. Then cold protection is considered as the conservative measure, and some of the drugs, medical drugs like calcium channel blocker can be used for the vasodilation of the vessel, and some of the other drugs can also be used, like steroid is also given to some of the patient. And what calcium channel? Usually nifedipine is given, okay. And the other measure can be some in severe cases, and we can also perform sympathetic combing. Lumbar sympathetic nerve is removed. Sympathectomy can be done. These are some of the, this is done only in a patient who is severely affected by the Raynaud's vasospasm, and can benefit for only short period, okay. This is not long term therapy. Now we will relatively correlate the Borger disease with this Raynaud's phenomenon. Look, the Raynaud's was, the key word in the Raynaud's was cold exposure, as in case of primary, whereas the Borger disease is predisposed by smoking. And what the smoking does? Usually the smoking causes vasospasm and hyperplasia of the intima. Look, vasospasm and hyperplasia of the intima. As a result, there will be thrombosis and obliteration in the blood vessel, and usually this affects medium and small sized blood vessel. Smoking is causes vasospasm as well as hyperplasia, and this will result in the segmental panarteritis. Means after vasospasm and hyperplasia of the intima layer, there will be thrombosis and obliteration of the blood vessel, and then there will be inflammation in the, and this inflammation will cause involvement of the artery, vein and nerve, all the inflammation in the artery. Then this will result the involvement of artery, vein and nerve, all the surrounding structure of the artery will be involved now. So once the nerve is involved in this inflammation, there will be pain started in the patient. The key culprit is the smoking, which is causing vasospasm. Now, after the involvement of these all structure, the perfusion to the tissue via this artery is diminished. Suppose that this was a medium-sized artery, then once this intimal layer is hyperplacing and there is vasospasm, then obviously that the it is obvious that the end organ or the muscle in the limbs will be affected. Then what happens? The collaterals, which is as we knew in the earlier section, that the vasa vasorum is the blood vessel which supplies this medium or large size vessel. Then the vasa vasorum will dilate and form collateral to perfuse this tissue, because the main artery to this tissue is completely stenosed or narrowed down. So this collateral will be responsible to relieve the symptom for some time. Okay, so this will present, this will be compensatory peripheral vascular mechanism for some period. And now if the patient still continues to smoke, means what is happened now, the collaterals are developed from the artery to the in tissue, but even after this period, if the patient continues to smoke, then this mechanism of vasospasm and hyperplasia of the endothelium will also be seen in this collateral, and finally the collateral will also gets dissolved or stenosed, and then the patient will undergo gangrenous necrosis. So did you get me? Now I will repeat again, means smoking predisposes vasospasm and hyperplasia of endothelium, intima layer mein hyperplasia hua jiske karan inflammation, and then it will involve the nerve too, which is responsible for the pain. And after this vasospasm of the medium sized artery, there will be origin of the collateral to perfuse or to compensate the hypoperfusion to the end organ, and the collateral will maintain the perfusion for some period, and once the smoking is again continued, then even the collateral will also be stopped due to the vasospasm. So this was the pathophysiology behind the Werger disease, and usually there are three components present in the Werger disease, as in case of the Reynolds phenomenon also. The three components can be remembered as TOR. T is for the thrombophlebitis. O is the obstruction of occlusive disease. O is occlusive disease, usually in the radial, tibial and plantar artery, and R is the Reynolds syndrome. So it is not necessary that all three components should be present. One or two of these three manifestation is sufficient for the diagnosis of the Werger disease. Any occlusive disease in the radial, tibial or plantar artery, thrombophlebitis or Reynolds syndrome. So the clinical feature of Werger disease is somewhat different from the Reynolds phenomenon, as it can also present with intermittent claudication of the foot. And we should also remember that in Werger disease, foot as well as hand both can be affected, and there can be intermittent type of claudication in the foot, and later it can progress to wrist pain, ulceration and gangrene also. Pain, gangrene and ulceration, and superficial thrombophlebitis can also be presented. So these were some of the clinical feature in the Werger disease. Now we will look for the investigation, which is very important portion of the for the diagnosis of the Werger disease. We will look for hemoglobin, means blood investigation mein we will look for the hemoglobin. Then we will look for the sugar to rule out diabetic foot or diabetic vasculopathy. Arterial Doppler or duplex scan can also be done. Doppler or duplex. Now we will go for the angiogram, and angiogram will be our gold standard and show the collateral formation. Angiogram will show the collateral and the some of the important signs or the appearance that will be seen in the angiography is, if we are performing transfemoral, means angiogram via which artery we are injecting the radioopaque substance, then it can be transfemoral or it can be transbrachial, and it will show collateral formation, and the appearance will be cork screw appearance, inverted tree spider leg collateral can be there, and if the transfemoral angiogram is not sufficient, then only we will perform transbrachial. Means normal transfemoral agar aa gaya, then we will perform transbrachial. Now this is all the treatment modality for the Borger disease, and at last we will remember the Borger disease treatment, which is also similar in case of the gangrenous disease. So this can be remembered as caps are gossip. CAPS is for the calcium channel blocker, A is the aspirin to prevent clot formation, aspirin, and P is the pentoxyphilin, which increases the fragility of the RBC. Pentoxyphilin increases the fragility of the RBC and prevents it from the microcirculation. And other P is the prostacycline can be given, or praxiline can be given, cycline or praxiline. And this is the surgical treatment for the Borger disease, that is either gene therapy by giving vasculoendothelial growth factor. जीन थेरेपी में क्या दिया जाता है, तो वेस्कुलो इंडोथेलियल ग्रोथ फैक्टर, एंड ओ इज द ओमेंटोप्लास्टी, एस इज द लंबर सिंपैथेक्टोमी एज वी डिड इन केस ऑफ रिनोल्ड्स आल्सो, एंड दिस इज इलिजारो मेथड ऑफ बोन लेंथनिंग. दिस हेल्प्स इन इंप्रूविंग द रेस्ट पेन एंड क्लाउडिकेशन. इलिजारो बोन लेंथनिंग मैकेनिज्म थेरेपी, बोन लेंथनिंग इज डन, दिस इज यूजुअली डन फॉर द ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ द क्लाउडिकेशन एंड पेन, एंड द लास्ट इज द पी, एंड दिस इज प्रोफोंडोप्लास्टी. एंड प्रोफोंडोप्लास्टी इज डन फॉर द ब्लॉकेज ऑफ द प्रोफोंडा फेमोरिस आर्टरी, सो एज टू ओपन मोर कोलेटरल अक्रॉस द नी जॉइंट. So these are all the treatment modality. This is the medical treatment by giving calcium channel blocker as vasodilator, aspirin to perform prevent from clot formation, and pentoxyphilin increases the fragility of the RBC to prevent it during microcirculation, and this GOSIP is the surgical treatment. So this is all about the Reynolds and Borger disease. Thank you.